House Better Call Somebody!
Hey yo, it's me, the R to the P, and yes, you better call somebody and tell them that the Old Culture Podcast has new merch.
Finally!
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 Yes, finally, more than 20 items in stock at oldculturepodcast.com/merch. Slap that sigil on your chest like a Superman or Wonder Woman and spread the message of infinite love, truth, and awareness. Both unisex and women's fits now available in a slew of different styles, including high-quality American apparel, tees, tanks, crop tops, hoodies, and long sleeves, plus designs that show off your wokeness, and hats for the alchemist deep within you, because we are on a mission to
make America great again.
Oh, no, Donald, you silly fuck. That's make alchemy great again. So transmute your wardrobe from lead to gold and conjure up oldculturepodcast.com/merch. And you know what? Do that now and use coupon code Equinox and enjoy 10% off on all orders from now through the fall equinox. That's now through Sunday, September 23rd.
You gotta be fucking kidding.
Nah, dude, I'm not. I've labored for far too long on this to let this merch just sit around. 10% off through Sunday, September 23rd with the coupon code Equinox at oldculturepodcast.com/merch. That's through the web store, not the Etsy shop. So follow the link in the show notes and manifest your heart's desire for some new swag, because what fun is casting spells and summoning spirits without cozy ritual attire? That's oldculturepodcast.com/merch. Use the coupon code Equinox, that's E-Q-U-I-N-O-X, and get 10% off all orders for the rest of the summer. Now let's drop that needle and roll that intro. Yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to Old Culture. I am Ryan Peverly, your party host for the next hour. Thanks for tuning in to the old D program. And you know, when we talk about deprogramming, we're talking about unlearning what we think is true, what we think we know, and exposing ourselves to new thoughts and new ideas and new feelings, and forming a new reality for ourselves instead of allowing one to be formed for us. And this conversation that you're about to hear strips away what we think we know, but on a wider socio-cultural level, this is reflective of a completely different paradigm, and one that most of us here in modern Western society are unfamiliar with. And who better to walk us through that paradigm than our guests, Tayana Lee McQuiller and Caitlin Foisey. They have recently collaborated on a project called the Sybil's Oraculum, Oracle of the Black Doves of Africa, which is a system of divination inspired by the Libyan Sybils, the African prophetesses of the classical world. The deck was created by Tayana, a tarot reader and researcher of religion, esoterica, and mysticism, and drawn by Caitlin, a visual artist, writer, and occultist who specializes in vintage-style mixed-media art and photography. This contemporary oracle pays homage to the oft-forgotten African founding mothers of the Sibylline traditions. Drawing on both the African and the classical traditions, the card art is in a style reminiscent of the Libyan mosaics popular in the 1st century BCE. And in the deck's accompanying guidebook, Tayana details how to consult the oracle, providing an in-depth write-up about the meaning of each of the 44 cards and the symbolic language represented by each card's imagery. There's also a really cool history of the Sybils of the ancient world and an exploration of the continuing Sybil tradition in North Africa today. But the framework for our conversation here comes from the true intention of the deck, which is to directly address the spiritual lessons underlying the seeker's question and to facilitate self-examination and decision-making and help improve the likelihood of success and broaden the perspective of the situation. Now, we did have some audio and some connection issues, so that cut this chat a bit shorter than usual. You will notice Tayana's connection got better about halfway through because we had to reconnect a couple times during this call. But please do stick with it because I quite liked it and I hope you do as well. Enjoy. Tayana Lee McQuillar, thanks for being here.
Thank you so much for having me.
No problem. And Caitlin Foisey, welcome back.
Thank you so much for having me again.
No problem. The pleasure's all mine. Caitlin, you made a cameo here before, and I'll link to that episode so people can hear more about you and, you know, how you became the Mistress of Magic. We talked for a few minutes about that. But Tayana, you're a first-time guest, so let's start with you. Tell us a little bit about yourself and your background and how you came to be interested in subjects like magic and tarot and, I guess, just the greater occult world that we seem to be living in.
I think that started for me just being a history buff, just going to museums a lot as a child and being interested in the tools, the Masonic tools and the pyramids and things of that nature. That really inspired me, and it really made me want to understand more about the behind the scenes or the backdoor action, if you will, you know, behind the world that we live in. I always kind of had a sense that there was more to every story I was hearing in history class. But whenever I asked questions, I was just told to kind of be quiet or whatever. So I asked my mom to buy me a set of Encyclopedia Britannica, which for those of you that are a little on the younger side, you know, that was a really big deal in the 80s. And I just kind of read from A to Z, and I started finding really cool stuff, UFOs, just all kinds of occult subjects just was fascinating to me, and religion in particular. I was very, very fascinated by religion, and Joseph Campbell was also a big influence to watching him on PBS. And he wrote all about myths and all the things I was interested in. And he answered a lot of the questions that my teachers didn't know the answer to or just refused to discuss. So that was kind of my intro.
All right. So you grew up in Manhattan. What was that religious and spiritual environment like in your household or in the community?
My mother, she's agnostic. My family are Baptist, but we also have a lot of root workers in my family, just sort of a conglomeration of African and Native American traditions kind of thrown together with a bit of European influence. And that's also, you know, been kind of the spiritual backdrop in my family. So it's always been there, but people just didn't discuss it. It was taboo. It's something that people were heavily persecuted for. It's also, root work is also known as hoodoo. And these kind of things have just been discussed, you know, and you just have to kind of sit around and listen to the adults talk about those things. And if you ask questions, you know, people, we're not talking about anything, just go away, you know, or just finish snapping the peas, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah.
But that really was my introduction. My mom just didn't really care about any of that. She just didn't. And as far as Midtown Manhattan, I grew up a phone throw away from Times Square, you know. Really not a spiritual environment here. It's all about making money and, you know, hustle and bustle. So it wasn't necessarily my environment in terms of my neighborhood, but definitely just my own family history and the things I've already mentioned that really got me started.
Yeah. So Caitlin, why don't you tell us a little bit about how you and Tayana met and then how this interesting project that you guys have just put out came to be?
We met through a mutual friend, and she just grabbed both of us and was like, you guys are going to love each other. And we spent the entire night in the corner talking to each other.
Right.
And we didn't talk to anyone else. We found our place and we just started talking.
Yeah.
And then, you know, over time, you know, we just kept the conversation going, and then one day, you know, Tayana messaged me and she was like, hey, I got to talk to you. I have this idea and I think that you would be a great artist for it. And I was like, okay, tell me about it. And, you know, she told me the idea and I was like, oh my God, yes. I was like, obviously I'm going to say yes to anything that you send to me because it's brilliant.
Thank you.
And, you know, we just had this dialogue about it. I read about it. You know, I did up the sample pieces and, you know, it was just kind of magic from there. You know, we just decided that it was going to be a magical experience, like throughout the entire process. And, you know, we just both had really kind of like clear ideas about it. So, you know, it was very much a collaborative effort. So, you know, when it comes down to sketching, you know, you're thinking of symbolism and you're doing all this stuff. And I sent it over to Tiana and she's like, I like this. She was like, but how about for this one, we use this? And it's like, oh yeah, why didn't I think of that? You know? And it's just really nice to have, you know, a partner that when you bounce off ideas off of each other, it just works. And, you know, that's sort of the magic, like behind a little bit of this deck. I have a million and one thoughts I could probably say right now. But I loved the historical aspects of it. I loved the idea of using, you know, like the mosaics. I loved all the symbolism behind it. And so, you know, obviously when she proposed this to me, I was like, yeah, I absolutely want to be a part of this. I want to have these images that have both past and present in them and that can relay these messages.
Yeah. And, you know, speaking of the history, let's get into some of that. And let's also tell the listener first, I guess, what the project is called. And hey, if I mispronounce something throughout this conversation, please do not hesitate to correct me. So, but I believe the title is The Sibyl's Oraculum, Oracle of the Black Doves of Africa. And this is, like you alluded to, Caitlin, a divination deck. Tiana, you've also written a book to accompany it, sort of, I guess, right? It's more of like an introduction to the deck. But let's get into some of the details and the history behind this. And Tiana, let's start with you. You noted in the book that this is an oracle inspired by the Libyan Sibyls. So I guess, first off, what is a Sibyl exactly?
A Sibyl is a wise woman, plain and simple. The Sibyls in ancient Rome just wielded tremendous power. They counseled everybody of every social class you can imagine, from the emperor, king, to the, you know, just the peasant. I mean, she was available for everyone. And that's very, very important. And the fact that the Sibyls are not credited, the Libyan Sibyls are not often credited is really what inspired me to create this project, because Herodotus is where I got the Black Doves reference. Herodotus is a ancient Greek historian, and he tells this tale of Black Doves flying to Greece and inspiring the Oracle. And everybody knows about the Oracle of Amun or the Oracle of Dodona, but very few people know that this tradition came from Kemet, and that's the term for ancient Egypt that I use throughout the book, because I tried to keep indigenous names and places intact. Many ancient Egyptian or Kemetic gods have been renamed or reclassified. So I tried to stay true to the original names and titles as much as I could. And the project is super important, especially I think it's super important, especially today, where a lot of people from all walks of life we're kind of in this kind of post-Abrahamic consciousness, I guess that's the best way I can put it, for a lot of people. And ancient Rome, for good or for bad, has brought us all together, you know. And I thought that it'd be great to revive that and take advantage of this moment where people are more accepting of diversity, and diversity in scholarship in particular, because there's always been a concerted effort to keep, especially European history, very, very isolated, as if European civilization developed completely on its own. And that's what I wanted to do, is to kind of just piggyback on the energy that's flowing right now, which is beautiful.
So tell us a little bit more about the dove symbolism and, you know, like what exactly it means, because there was a detail in the book about it connecting to maybe a very popular star cluster that people may know of.
Right, the Pleiades. The dove, it was a symbol of the soul in the ancient Mediterranean. So you have these two black doves. Black, I guess, was, you know, we will never know. But, you know, it seems to allude to the skin color of the women who, like I said, was supposed to have come from Thebes. And the dove, it's a symbol of the constellation of Taurus, the Pleiades. And Pleiades means flock of doves. So the star cluster that we know of comes from the seven sisters of Greek mythology. That's Maya, Electra, Alcyone, Hygeia. I'm not really sure how to pronounce these myself, so excuse me. Asterope, Delano, Merope, all of these sisters are linked to Africa. So the dove symbolism is also found, of course, among the ancient Israelites and in the worship of Asherah, which was the consort of Yahweh. So that's how we got the dove symbolism in Christianity, you know, which symbolizes the Holy Spirit. So all of these things have this history, but we just kind of, like I said, just kind of cut it off with the Israelites, and we don't kind of go back to kind of analyze the pre-Abrahamic consciousness and what the dove meant to them. Aphrodite, there are innumerable deities that had this symbolism in the ancient Mediterranean.
Yeah, that's something that I learned, what you said about Christianity. I did not know that prior to reading through this, you know, that the, I guess the cross replaced the dove as the symbol of the Holy Spirit, I think you said in the 4th century CE. I did not know that. I thought that was a pretty interesting, do we know, I guess that, would that have been Constantine that did that?
Right. I mean, you have Constantine did a lot of damage, you know, the objective pretty much was just to assert kind of that, you know, like I said, these women had a tremendous amount of power, and it's just a multicultural situation. You know, we're talking about women just in general, just having an incredible amount of influence, and the church fathers wanted that power for themselves. So they just kind of erased what they could and burned who they could, but what they couldn't erase, they had to redefine or claim that heritage for themselves. And, you know, we see that a lot with, you know, holidays like Christmas. You know, I'm sure your listeners are very aware of the pre-Abrahamic celebrations that have, you know, been reclassified as something else because people just wouldn't stop. So they had to do something. And that's really how we got this kind of usurpation of all these symbols and concepts.
Yeah, and you said in the book, you noted how difficult it can be to write about these older cultures and societies, and I'm just curious what some of the challenges were when you were researching and, you know, during the writing and creation process of the deck, like what sort of obstacles did you guys come across?
Caitlin, you want to take that from an artistic perspective?
Sure. So some of the things that I came across were, so we focused on 1st century BCE, and there's a lot of things that are sort of categorized into, like, you know, certain time frames. And so, you know, I spent a lot of time researching things, but some of them are categorized wrong, you know, and that was one of the things that was, I was pulling my hair out over it. You know, I was like, oh my God, I did this fish. And what if it's not 1st century? Like, and someone looks at the deck and they notice and they're like, this isn't accurate. Like, that's what goes through my head. But, you know, there's a lot of things when you're looking up history, and there's so many different versions of the way that things happen that, you know, you're constantly looking at a number of different sources going, okay, so do these make sense together? And these two sort of make sense together, and this one doesn't make sense. And, you know, there's a lot of opinions when it comes to historical text as well. So, you know, you have people putting across opinions as fact. And, you know, I'm also of the same nature where it's just like, you know, if I go somewhere and I don't document it, does it mean I wasn't there, you know? And so I have to think about that. So when I was doing the artwork, I was definitely researching all these different, you know, aspects and these different mosaics and these different art pieces and these different, you know, paintings. And I was trying to kind of like put together a narrative from there. But I knew that, you know, no matter what I did, there was going to be something that, you know, like I said, you know, my mind works in, oh my God, you know, like if this isn't, you know, exactly the way it's supposed to be, like someone's going to notice. And I need to kind of like let that go. Cause I'm like, you know what? We don't know when it was actually categorized here. So I think in doing the art, like you just have to keep sort of like a more like open mind in that aspect. But, you know, I tried to keep everything that I could find. I tried to keep sources for it. So like I have files where I'm like, okay, you know, I found like this source, and I was just trying to keep track of everything. So you're doing the creative part, but you're also kind of, you know, categorizing all of these like images that you're looking up and trying to get inspiration from, and also kind of tapping into it, you know, from like a spiritual sense too. And you're like, okay, does this feel right? And that's why, you know, it was great for Tiana and I to bounce things off of each other, because you know, obviously she knows the historical aspects like so much deeper. So I can like send that to her and be like, hey, how do you feel about this? And she'll be like, yeah, no, that feels like it. Or, you know, no, that doesn't quite fit. Because sometimes I go into design mode and it's like all design all the time. But, you know, just from doing the deck and trying to research everything, it's most important to just pull from a number of different sources and just try to create the narrative from that. And whichever ones kind of add up and make sense. I guess that's the shorter version of my long-winded answer.
Well, that is difficult. This is something that Tayana said in the book too. It's challenging because I think one of you said this a few minutes ago. I think it was Tayana, you know, that it's just a lot of guesswork because you just don't know. Tayana said that in the book, and Caitlin, you sort of said that too during your answer. And Tayana, you know, with your background in, I guess, as a student of history, and then you also have an academic background in cultural anthropology, you noted that because of these centuries of conquest, it's so difficult to really find accurate information the further back you go. So during your process, what sort of obstacles did you encounter in that regard?
Well, I mean, the racism and the Eurocentrism is just a lot. I mean, it's just so much to comb through, and a lot of the sources, I mean, you know, people are products of their time, and just, I think that was the most difficult for me, just to kind of cut through all of the noise and just try to get to the meat of whatever I was reading, just the bare bones. And you'd be surprised how much, if once you just kind of have be like a horse with blinders, how little there is there. Just like what Caitlin just said, you know, just there's so much opinion, but it sounds sexy. And all these big words, and, you know, and I speak academia very well. It's just, but once you just kind of distill it, you really just have a little tiny bit of fact. So you just kind of extract that. But besides that, I think that my focus was more on, since it's dedicated to the Libyan civil, you know, just kind of stick to as much as I can, being an American living in the 21st century, try to stick to what their values were. Not necessarily, you know, what a 19th century historian is saying per se, in terms of their analysis, because their analysis is irrelevant because they are coming with their, you know, their prejudices and things of that nature. But just trying to stay true as I can to the values of these women, which is very different. Very different than the, you know, being, you know, most of them were from matriarchal or matrilineal cultures. I tried to put myself in their shoes, and being also a student of African spirituality for quite a long time, I know the fundamental ethics and the fundamental values that, you know, again, it's very hard to speak about African people in, you know, and paint them all with the same brush. But you know what I'm trying to say, you know, just a general value system that I try to stay true to and has been timeless. I mean, I've studied quite a bit of different systems that hail from Africa. And once you strip away just kind of aesthetics, and there are some things that are just there and has always been there, and I presumably will always be there. And that's what I tried to stay true to and use that knowledge and use that experience that I have to inform the writing.
Yeah, you definitely made a conscious effort to stick with the Libyan, you know, cultural context, I guess would be the best way to say that. And I thought that was really cool as I was reading through there. And I think some people too would be surprised to know that the legacy of the Sibyls and some of the Greco-Roman pantheon and mythology that we're all familiar with, or maybe more familiar with, that actually stems from these cultures, not just Libya, but these Northern African cultures. I was wondering if you could maybe tell us a little bit more about some of the things that are similar, some of the things that may have been outright stolen and renamed and sort of recast to fit a Greco-Roman narrative.
I think one of the major ones for me, I've always loved Medusa. Okay.
Me too.
Medusa has always been my favorite. I was, again, I'm a child of the 80s, so I watched Clash of the Titans. I think that was 82 or 83. And I just was horrified when she was beheaded, because I hadn't studied it in school at that time. So it was just, I really, you know, I hadn't studied myth the mythology in school. So it just shocked me. And I knew when I first saw her, I said, this is a black lady. And they just cut off her head, you know, and I intuited it. And at any rate, I think that, you know, she's an African deity. And so you have in myth, you know, it's these spiritual myths, they recount a history. So the cutting of Medusa's head is the end of, you know, kind of the symbolism of the end of that matriarchal, that matrilineal rule, that sibyl knowledge, you know, the snakes representing her wisdom. And Perseus just lops it off, you know, and uses her power against her. So, yeah, I mean, you have that, and, you know, Dionysus was another god that I really, really like. And, you know, he was raised in Libya. These are all in the myth, he's raised in Libya. So, you know, there are innumerable deities that were just outright stolen, or they told the truth, but it wasn't explained adequately for people to understand that these deities, and some of them were compounded. So you have like Amun, that are compounds of different deities, and Serapis, and, you know, you just have to know these things, but you don't learn them in school. You know, you have to really dig deep to understand the depth of this. And also Cleopatra with Elizabeth Taylor, that was another movie that I really enjoyed. And I saw these symbols and I said, wait a minute, Mark Anthony was a priest of Isis, or Julius Caesar is a priest of Isis. Like, why don't we hear about these things? Like, why don't we talk about them? Why don't we discuss what these people accomplished in the context of African culture? These men are actually Greek and Roman men are marrying African queens, but we don't make any effort to understand how that informed them spiritually and how that may have informed the decisions that they made. I found it very confusing as a child. So, you know, this is, you know, my effort to try to clarify for people, or to make people aware that Africa and Europe has always been connected, and, you know, kind of just also just kind of help to further the conversation, because I just feel that African people in general are not taken seriously. You know, you kind of had this kind of chasing zebras to slavery, to civil rights, you know, kind of narrative that plays out of people's head. And that really has real world consequences. And it's very harmful. You know, these omissions are extremely harmful for people, for Black people with African ancestry. That's very harmful. And it colors how people perceive their work because of all these omissions and reclassifications.
Right. And when you said Cleopatra, too, I was going to chime in. You know, that story has been rewritten so many times where it's just like, yeah, she was hot, you know, and they completely forgot that she spoke so many languages. She was incredibly smart. And these men fell in love with her because she was so smart. And she was just so, like, she just knew. So that was alluring. And that's completely cut out of, you know, what we learn about her growing up. I mean, I don't think I knew any of that until I was much, much older, like in my 20s.
And and I agree. That actually, in Cleopatra, in the film with Liz Taylor, there's one line. There's one line when Caesar's general is talking, and he says, oh, you know, if she was a man, one might consider her intellectual.
Right.
And then he proceeds to rattle off all the books that she wrote. I'm like, what might be considered intellectual? What the hell does it take?
Yeah.
You know, this woman was a scientist. This woman was a priestess, a high priestess, and a very good one. And this project is about so many different things. It's about, you know, combating the misogyny, about combating the Eurocentrism. And that's why I think it's really important, you know, to discuss these things. Thank you for mentioning Cleopatra, Caitlin. She does get a raw deal.
Well, and also, too, I mean, you know, in the card, the purity card, you know, there's like these two braids that are cut off, and it's like this, you know, secret society of women who are wise women. And, you know, if you go into now, like, Christian times, like, where it's like, you know, these nuns that are sort of right. doing the same thing, but it's completely different. You know, it's like, well, this is Chase and this is good. But, you know, going back to these secret societies back then, they're like, oh, no, that was witchcraft. Real bad, evil there, you know?
Exactly, exactly. And that's always a challenge when you're, you know, again, when you're, you know, when you're doing research about ancient cultures or just, or even now, you know, just reading about foreign cultures. It's a lot of this kind of descriptive language that's very, very damaging. And you don't even realize it, you know, unless you're like hypersensitive to these kind of things. You know, at this point, I'm, you know, I can pretty much just kind of cut it away. But what about people that are not there or just starting to learn? You know, you're programmed, you know, by the things you read. So if you're constantly reading that somebody was, you know, evil or immoral, that will definitely make an impression on whoever those people are right now. I can't emphasize that enough. Is the past is the present, very much so. And I think that more. I don't think I have to really, you know, drive that point home. Considering the state of the world today,
right?
Yeah, and I'm glad that you brought up that raw intelligence, because we're talking about the spiritual influence of the Libyan Sibyls on Greco-Roman culture. We're talking about maybe even their artistic influence. They even had some economic and socio-political influence as well. But one of the things I thought was really cool, though, was the African priestesses who were responsible for advancements in things like mathematics and astronomy. I don't think anybody listening would be that familiar with that. So I'd like to pull on that thread a little bit, and I'm going to attempt to pronounce their names, but maybe you could tell us about them and what those advancements were of people like Teki and Seshat. And I'm not even going to try to pronounce the one that's hyphenated. I'm just going to turn the mic over to you and just tell us a little bit more about these African priestesses who made these advancements in these curious intellectual areas.
So I'm sure that everybody has heard of Thoth. Let's start there. And his African name is Tahuti. Thoth is the god of wisdom in the Kemetic or ancient Egyptian pantheon. So Thoth, as the god of wisdom, he had a wife who was the goddess, I guess you can say that, a goddess of wisdom and knowledge. And she gave him that knowledge. So Seshat is actually the source. She's the master mason here, which is a big jaw-dropper for a lot of people who have never heard that. So what you have to understand about a lot of African deities is that more often than not, they are deified ancestors. So then, you know, the names are not just coming out of thin air, or the concepts are not coming out of thin air. They're usually people that did extraordinary work for their communities, and they are in turn rewarded with immortality. It's a reward for exceptional service. And that is what a priest is and what a priestess is. Being a priestess or a priest in African tradition was never about a graduation, if you will, like, you know, you just kind of arrived. It's an acknowledgement of humility. It's a humble thing. So at any rate, I just wanted to get that, just say that. So yeah, Teki Seshat and Atur Shema. The T sound being feminine in the Kemetic language. So Teki is credited with the creation of geometry. Seshat is credited with the creation of trigonometry. And Atur Teshemet is credited with the creation of calculus. Okay, so this all happened more than 4,000 years ago. So we get this information from Gerald Massey, Mikhanowski, and classicist and historian Livio Sacchini. And these are, you know, again, this is history that's kind of forbidden history, kind of hidden history, so that's why a lot of people don't know about it. And it's, considered fantastical. But it's very key that we understand that the reason, again, going back to that, just kind of this narrative of European supremacy, this is the reason why we don't really hear about these facts that much. I hope I answered your question.
Yeah, and Caitlin, I'm wondering, did you learn that from working on this project, or did you know all that prior to?
No, I learned that from working on this project.
Wow.
Well, as I say, I mean, that's pretty cool. I obviously learned it while reading this project, but it was still fascinating to me. There's other concepts too, like, well, I guess going back to mathematics, so this means that if the evidence is correct, that Pythagoras is not the father of mathematics. It means that concepts credited to people like Plato were already being discussed or known in Africa long before they were encountered by the Greeks. So
yes, exactly.
I know that the historical patriarchy is very well defined, but to think that it really goes like this deep, where I don't think the average person listening would even be aware of the term black doves of Africa and know that these priestesses even existed, let alone had this sort of an impact on the world that they were living in at the time. So, I mean, it does bring up a good point about the patriarchal nature of society and culture that we've all grown up in. A great gift given to us by the Greeks and the Romans. And of course, I'm being sarcastic there. But I'm curious, how matriarchal were these older African cultures? Was it a complete 180 from where we are right now? Or was there more of a balance between patriarchy and matriarchy?
Again, these concepts, these terms are just, it's very hard because they're to define indigenous cultures using these kind of foreign concepts. You know, there's just, it's always been a balance. There was no power was passed through the woman. So your identity was inherited through your mother. So that's why Isis or Aset, being her African name, that's why she had a throne on her head, because it was through her that you could sit on the throne. So that's really how the matrilineal aspect works in many African cultures, or so-called matriarchal cultures. But again, the terms are problematic. There's always been a balance. Everybody had a role to fulfill. And it really is a problem when you kind of speak on, especially ancient cultures. You know, again, we really don't know as much as we think we do. Just kind of thinking about African cultures as they exist today, and the cultures that follow their traditional spirituality, you still see this balance of energies, and nobody is supposed to be above the other. Everybody is supposed to, you know, both males and females are supposed to assist one another and assist their community as a whole. That is the ultimate goal, not for any one gender to have power over the other.
Yeah, and it does seem like, and please let me know what you think of this, but it does seem like that we are slowly getting back to that point. I mean, you know, maybe not if you look out into, I guess, you know, mainstream pop culture, it doesn't really seem that way. But on the streets, you know, like it does seem like we're getting back to that sort of balance. At least that's how I feel. Do you guys feel the same way?
I think it's starting to. You know, I think that what we're seeing right now, I mean, there's definitely a resistance against it, but there's also, you know, people are realizing like, okay, like I have certain talents. And I think that, or at least in my case, and what I'm seeing around is people are noticing the different talents. So you can have two different people that have different gifts or different talents that they're using, and each person has like their place in the community. But we're also fighting against like years and years of it being like, well, this is your role and this is your role. So, you know, we're kind of like in an in-between space for me, at least. I know that my path has been like a little bit different because I, you know, from a young age, it was just like, okay, this is what I'm good at, you know, and like, I'm just going to go here. And, you know, I know I'm really bad at this stuff, and it didn't really matter to me because I just knew, I was like, this is what I'm good at and this is what I'm going to do. But, you know, we're in a time and space where things are really changing. And, you know, we've been in this sort of gendered like society for a really, really long time. And now like the younger generations are just like, well, no, like we're questioning this, you know? So there's a little bit of like this learning curve that's happening right now too. And that's sort of my take on it.
I think that just coming from, you know, just being a Black American, it's always, you know, Black American culture has always been kind of denigrated for being very mama focused, very matriarchal, you know, for lack of a better term. So that pressure, I don't think is as much for me, because like I said, you know, there's always been in Black American culture, an acceptance of women being empowered. There's always been an acceptance, you know, out of necessity as well, just having priestesses. And, you know, this is something that is just normal. for women to always have an opinion. And, you know, it's just a totally different approach to living than mainstream society. And as a result, the same criticisms, negative criticisms, as these ancient cultures of being infantile or underdeveloped, this kind of thing, that these kind of criticisms about balanced cultures or women, empowered women, well, cultures with empowered women, let's put it that way. Those are the bad terms and that are used. And so in terms of mainstream culture, I see there's a tremendous fight. And there are a lot of people that don't want to see this balance restored. And I think that there's going to, that fight is going to continue, at least, I think, in my lifetime. I don't think that I will live to see kind of this utopia or closer to utopia. I think that that's going to take some time.
Yeah, I mean, over years, I mean, and history just tells us it's always going to take time. You know, it's like,
absolutely.
You know, we're in the midst of it right now, that we're seeing the resistance to it. You know, we're seeing things being sort of torn down and built back up. And it's just at a point where, and I grew up in a family where my grandmother was like, you know, she was like the head of it, you know, So I think growing up like that, like, you know, you were saying, like in this matriarchy, I think it really, I didn't know what it was like to grow up in, you know, like a family where it's like, oh, it's all about the father. Cause my dad just wasn't, you know, he wasn't into that kind of power. You know, he was just like, yeah, like let's help out your grandmother, you know? So I don't think I understood that until later in life either. So, you know, again, like my upbringing was very matriarchal, and I don't think I understood what these roles were until a little bit later.
I agree. I saw it on television.
Yes, me too. Me too. I think it's like, what was it, like Leave It to Beaver and all of those. Now I sound like, but like,
yeah,
you know, I loved those black and white shows and just sort of seeing those. And I was like, oh, you know, but it was separate from what I was living. So.
That's an interesting point. Yeah. So let's transition into the actual cards now, the artwork and the symbolism there. I'm just curious what, and maybe you guys have already talked to this, but what were the primary inspirations for the cards, and what messages were you trying to convey through the actual images?
Well, I mean, they were inspired by the Libyan mosaics of the first century BCE, and we tried to take each card and each definition and tap into the symbolism of like what would convey that best and what would also tap into past and present, you know, bringing it right into the now. So what I do in my process with this is, you know, I'll research, I'll grab bits and pieces. So, you know, you may see like bits and pieces of, you know, an actual artifact put into the card and, you know, and used in that way so that it's bringing that past into the present, into that reading, into tapping into the knowledge of the sibyls. So a lot of that for me is in the research, researching different stories, looking into, you know, different stories that, you know, like were passed down or things that I can kind of like find that, you know, were in, you know, say for instance, like hieroglyphics, or, you know, we're on like, you know, vases, or we're on what is the story that someone is trying to tell you about what they were living like at that time, or what they were experiencing, or what they were believing in. So for me, a lot of the symbolism went into that. You know, I'm trying to place myself there and be like, okay, what were the animals there that were during the time? And I mean, I can't even tell you how many times I Googled, were there blah, blah, blah in, you know, because the last thing you want is like, well, isn't that an animal from Northern Ohio? You know, but it's, you know, for me, a lot of it is tapping into those stories that are, that still exist. And I like to do this thing when I'm working where I call it listening to walls. And so I'll look at the image and I'll sort of just try to tap into it, you know, almost thinking about like pressing my ear to the wall and being like, okay, what do you have to tell me? And that's where I go as far as like the symbolism. You know, a lot of it, like we spoke about, you know, we talked about mythology, we talked about these different pyramids and different sacred spaces and places and different rituals And it's all of that and all of that storytelling that sort of makes the imagery for me.
I would just say that I wanted the symbolism to reflect that timelessness, you know, because all these animals are still here. All the fruits are still here. We may not use the technology from back then, but we can perceive it. I just really wanted this deck to feel old, but also feel very current and let those symbols kind of communicate through, across time and space, you know, which is what symbols are supposed to do, but just make people understand that those people are not back there. Go to the courthouse, you'll see the temple right there. You know what I mean? And you'll see the same God staring back at you, but now you'll know a little bit. You know, hopefully after using this deck, you can watch your favorites. You can watch your old episodes of Xena and you know, with a new light, or maybe Gladiator. You know what I mean? Just I think that's also a big issue with people sometimes, is the failure to connect dots, you know, because we all have a lot of information, especially now. I mean, every time you log on, you're probably, you know, if you have my Facebook friends, forget it. You know, you're always learning something new. But this could just be a lot of useless data that you could just kind of be pretentious about and, you know, whatever. But if you connect, just start connecting dots, and also, and you're the dot too. That's key. You are the eagle. You are these different symbols. You are the mirror. There's no such thing as an inanimate object in this deck, if you understand this deck. You understand? So those are the messages.
Well, there was something in the book too about awakening the symbols. And you said that they reflect the experiences of cosmopolitan people of the ancient Mediterranean. And because of that, some of the symbols, or most of them, may be unfamiliar to the audience, to the Western audience, which means that you have to awaken them in your consciousness. So what would be the best way to go about doing that, you think?
For me, I like to spend time with them. What I would do is I would spend time with each card. You know, I would sit there and look at it. I would, you know, write down the symbolism if I can, or see if anything sort of comes to me, you know, and I would just sit there and look at the imagery. There's something really special that happens when you sit with imagery and you just sit there and you look at it and you sort of like connect with it. And that's sort of what's, you know, awakening the energy there. Also, there's a Romani thing that I do when I want to wake things up, and that's I blow on them 3 times. And it's, you're basically putting your life essence into the cards.
Mm. Well, for me, I focus on what makes me uncomfortable first. I'm a typical Scorpio. you know, like, you know, that's what I did when I first got my first tarot deck. I looked through the cards. Oh. And then when I got to one, I hated, or just, you know, any kind of reaction that made me feel funny. Those are the cards I focus on. I focus on first. And that has worked for me, because those were the cards I knew that I needed to know more about and really reflect on, you know, what's going on here. Why is this beautiful image? You know, the art could be beautiful, but obviously it's something else. And I think that if people, you know, before you get into the instructions and all of that jazz, I think that I agree with Caitlin. Just go through the deck one by one. Identify that card that makes you gonna want to go, ew, and then jot that down and, you know, just really reflect. It's really all about reflection. That's what awakening is, always.
Yeah, absolutely. And even when I do the cards, you know, I'm always interested in which ones I want to do first and which ones I like. Right. I'm sort of like hesitating on, and I'm like, oh, I probably need that.
Yeah. That's right.
So one of the things that fascinates me about tarot and divination decks is the correspondences. If you look at like Rider-Waite-Smith, there's a ton of correspondences between just a host of different things, Hermeticism, Kabbalah, etc. What are some of the main correspondences in here from mythologies that people may be unfamiliar with, or actually that they may know of? Just give us a couple that stood out to you that made its way into the deck.
Well, I mean, there's a few different things. I mean, you know, you'll see things like in the doubt card, you know, there's an eye with 3 swords in it. And, you know, and this is something that's been painted and created over time, where it's like this aversion of the evil eye, where it's just like, what is doubt? But doubt is like, you know, like this fear, you know, so you're seeing things like that. you have just certain, you know, symbolism from like Greek culture, from Roman culture, even from Egypt. You know, you have the scarab there that's, you know, sort of tapping into that ancient wisdom. You have a lot of these sort of like mythological like beasts, you know, from like the sea that are sort of tapping into those aspects in the deck. There's, you know, especially like an initiative where it's like, you know, half horse, half fish. And, you know, it's just like, okay, you know, like we're tapping into these, you know, like different aspects of like that mythology. I'm trying to think if there's anything that, you know, people wouldn't know about it. Maybe with Cleopatra's bath, you know, and in the play card, thinking about that, you know, and there's all of these different stories about Cleopatra's bath, and people are now fighting to figure out if it even existed, you know, and people have different locations for it. There's all of these different aspects, but I think it really depends on, you know, what people are relating to. I think in the nurturing card, we put a deathing ritual where there's like a coin over a skull on the mouth, and just sort of like this attention to the rituals of death and how the dead were nurtured. Whereas like, you know, nowadays, like there is like this weird sort of like disconnection, especially like in Western culture with death itself. And it's like, you know, it's like we have these very sterile sort of funerals, or some people do. I mean, some people, like my family, just has a big party, but you know, like it's like, wow, it kind of depends. Cool. Yeah, we just have memorials where it's like, let's party, but they don't want us to cry. But you know, there's a lot of this where it's like, well, you're supposed to, you know, be in an act of mourning, and we have a little bit of a hands off thing with death right now. Whereas, you know, I go to a funeral and the first thing I want to do is I want to touch the person, and people are like, Caitlin, stop, and I'm like, no, like I want to connect with them, even if they're not here physically, you know? So that was one of the aspects that I actually really liked, you know, like doing like in the deck too, with like deathing rituals. It's like in the nurture card, I loved the idea of like, here we are nurturing this. And, you know, there's so many different aspects of kind of like what, you know, we put into the deck, you know, like the caracoles for, you know, transcendence. And one of my favorite cards is actually, Tiana came up with this, was like, you know, like the stillness card with the crocodile and sort of like in the water, just still and just sort of waiting. You know, there's all of these tales from different cultures where it's like, you know, there's always that stillness. There's always that stillness story of like the, you know, the crocodile, the alligator, like waiting in the water to come up and catch, you know, and it's like this whole story to kind of teach kids to like, be careful, watch, you know, like there's stillness there. There's patience there. You've got to watch. So, you know, these are just some of the things that are sort of coming up to me like offhand. Some of them are a bit generalized, but, you know, that's just sort of what's coming up to me in conversation right now. What about you, Tiana?
Well, each card, yeah, each card has a religio-mythological association. So you will have deities from different pantheons, and you're going to get a little history nugget in every card, really. And my favorite card is Limitation. And that has to be my favorite card, just because, you know, it's wonderful that we live in a, you know, that the popular narrative right now is, you know, be free and you can do whatever you want. And that has consequences, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that we're seeing those consequences, you know, and we will continue to see the consequences of just no concept of, you know, it's a filthy word, limitations, boundaries. These are things that, you know, are taboo because this Western society has been just so prim and just very controlled, and everything just had to be so by the book. And it's wonderful that people are expressing themselves and they're exploring, but none of these civilizations would have accomplished what they've accomplished if they didn't have very clear objectives and very clear limitations and boundaries at every step. And and anybody that's successful, whether they be in business or guru or whatever, they had to stay on task. And I think that this deck, it goes, you know, it might be a little dark for some people just because no reality is shunned here. And, you know, that's just me as a person. I, you know, I shoot from the hip and I say what I feel, and I don't run away from being uncool. Let's put it that way. You know, I don't think woke looks a certain way. I don't think it talks a certain way. I don't perform spirituality, which I think is expected a lot in a lot of these kind of divination. You know, I've had hundreds of decks in my life, and I feel that there's a lot of sunshine and, you know, and that's wonderful in some flowers. But you know what? Sometimes people just need the truth, and they just need to be told like it is to in order to get something. So, you know, these are all things that went into that. These are all things that went into the creation of this deck.
I think maybe my favorite thing that you wrote in the book portion of this was that this is not a fortune-telling tool. It's explicitly designed for self-examination, and you actually likened it to homeopathic medicine, which I liked because I'm a fan of that as well. But let's tell it like it is, though, on this last question for you both. For anyone who comes across the deck and uses it, what do you ultimately hope they take from it?
I think that for me, I think that a lot of times, you know, when we're on a spiritual path, you know, we're looking for these answers or, you know, or we get caught up in the mundane stuff, you know, like these love questions or these money questions. But the thing with this deck and the thing that I like about it so much is that it gets to the deeper issue and the core issue, which is, you know, like, what is it within you that is in need of these things or these things that you're sort of focusing on as so important? What is the core of it? You know, a long time ago, I was reading this thing on, you know, William S. Burroughs, and not that he has anything to do with the Sibyls, but he was talking about how divination is this tool. And he was like, when I do divination, he was like, I need to find the core of it. He was like, you may not be able to find a job, but what is the core of it? So he'll look into the core. And I was like, this is exactly what this deck does. It's getting to that core issue. So you can be like, okay, what is it within me that I am like hesitating on this? Or what is this within me that's fearing this? And then it gives you these actions. And for me, like, that is like very much like, oh, great. Like, now I have this, you know, issue that I'm like sort of like, you know, like dealing with. And like, now I have these answers that I get to work on. I get to work on these two things, or, you know, these three things. And I get to kind of like fix this for myself. So, you know, this is exciting to me. You know, it's exciting to me to find the core issue, the root issue. And I think that's something that I hope that people that are using this deck really sort of like focus on, is getting to that root issue. Because I mean, root issues can keep us, you know, backwards for years.
Exactly.
And, you know, and our mission on, you know, like this, like spiritual life or even regular life, you know, it doesn't even matter, is to move forward. So that's what I hope that people take from it, is that they can get the answers to that root issue and be able to work on that and have the tools to work on that.
I think Caitlin said it all. I mean, one thing that we all have in common, all humans have in common, is pain. Just pain. Confusion is pain. It hurts. Something's going on in your life and you're like, what the hell am I going to do now? And that's what divination is for. It's pain management. Let's be real. Because if everything was going perfect, you probably would never buy the Sibyls. You wouldn't buy the tarot. You wouldn't listen to a culture. If you're not confused, if you're not wondering, if you're not pondering, and these things can't, like I said, can be painful because you want the answers to these burning questions. And so pain management is essential. I mean, we've recently, you know, the world is, you know, in a tailspin of all these deaths and, you know, celebrities killing themselves and all kinds of. So getting to the core issue, you know, hopefully this deck will save somebody. You know, it's really about just saving lives, man. Just really helping people through those times in life when, you know, you just don't know where else to turn. Maybe there's not somebody that can call you on the phone to chat with you for 7 hours about, you know, everybody has such a busy schedule nowadays. You know, everybody's ripping and running. And I just wanted the Sibyls deck to be there, to be that friend, if you will, you know, to kind of guide you through those dark times, or even just those times where you just, hey, what's going on in my head? Maybe I don't even know how I feel. You know what I mean? Sometimes you just don't, you know, at least for me, sometimes I really can't figure out whether I'm sad or I'm angry or I'm confused. I don't know. So during those times, you could kind of maybe extract that information from yourself, because you do know, but maybe you just need a tool to help you really focus.
Well said. Well said. You really cut to the core there too on both of your answers. So I do appreciate that. And let's wrap up here. Just tell people where they can find the Sibyls Oraculum if they're interested in, I guess, getting to the core of their own issues here.
You can find the deck on numerous sites, innertraditions.com, on their website. You can find it on Amazon. You can find it on barnesandnoble.com. I think any bookseller site is going to have it right now.
That's right. And you can contact me at Tayanna Lee. That's TayannaHlee at gmail.com. You can just drop me a note and, you know, just tell me how you feel. Let me know how the deck is working out for you. Just whatever you want to say. I'd love to hear from you. Friend request me. Just reach out.
Yeah, and you can find me at KaitlinFoisy.com, KatelanFoisy.com. And I'm pretty easy to find on Facebook and Instagram, all under the same name.
Absolutely. Well, Caitlin, I'm sure that you and I will speak again soon. And Tayanna, if you're up for it, let's talk again soon, because one, I'm also I'm also a Scorpio, so we have a lot to talk about.
Yay!
There. But
I'm
also
a Taurus, but I gather my Scorpios.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
She collects yeah. us, Ryan.
Yeah. So Caitlin Foisy, Tayanna Lee McQuiller, thank you so much for being here. Take care of yourselves.
You too. Thank you again. Bye.
And there you have it. My thanks again to Tayanna and Caitlin. Love their hustle, love their flow, love their work, and love their message that they came to this chat with. And I hope you did too. There was quite a lot to unpack there in a short amount of time. Tayanna brought the heat there towards the end. I love that line, woke doesn't look a certain way. And also sometimes people just need to be told the truth. Could not agree more. And Caitlin bringing some heat too, talking about how root issues can hold us back for long periods of time. Boy, do I know that for a fact, and I'm sure some of you out there do as well. And Tayanna's research into the Sibyl tradition of Libya and North Africa, and what all they accomplished and how it was stolen, repurposed, appropriated, however you want to word it, it's clear that these women are not getting their just due. I mean, to think that African priestesses may have been responsible for advanced mathematics and theories that have long been credited to Greek men like Pythagoras and Plato, well, that is quite the paradigm shift, and one that I personally tend to gravitate toward. It's funny, you know, when I look at my own personal growth here, it has been dominated by this internal union with my own feminine qualities, and I've seen a tremendous benefit because of that. And societally, a similar shift seems necessary. I do think it's in the very beginning stages, but we need to keep moving in that direction. Not to complete matriarchy, but to a more balanced place, which is what really set these women apart from their contemporaries. They understood that balance and helped bring it to their people. And I think the more we can do that individually, the more we'll see that societal shift continue. And who knows, maybe things like this deck that Tayanna and Caitlin have created can be a small part of that. No Patreon extension again this week due to the technical issues and time constraints caused by that, but a shout out to Destiny for hopping on board the Esoteric Endeavor recently. Thank you so much, Destiny. If you want to join Destiny in supporting the show and get access to all extensions, both past and future, as well as all the other rewards for patrons, patreon.com/oculture is the place to do that. And patrons at the $10 and $20 levels, I just dropped the date for the next Oculture Picture Show. That's our fancy way of saying movie night. Friday, September 7th, 10:30 p.m. Eastern, 7:30 p.m. Pacific. The poll is up on Patreon for you to vote what movie we stream. So check that out. Of course, you can also donate to the show in other ways too, which I have not mentioned recently. So if you're jonesing to send some money away, you know, we take debit and credit through PayPal, also cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, Ethereum, Ripple, whatever your flavor is. You can do that at occulturepodcast.com/donate. And of course, please do take advantage of the fall equinox sale that's ongoing and get 10% off all orders at occulturepodcast.com/merch. Anyway, that's all the plugs for me this time, which means I'm out of time. So until next time, you've just been initiated into Oculture. I am Ryan Peverly reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority.